So in this lecture, I'm going to talk about Git and GitHub. Git's a very powerful tool, and we're going to use it a lot in this class. But even for its uses in this class, it'll be very elementary. You know, it's mainly used for very large code development projects to track changes and additions to the code base. So, you know, if you had a career in software development, you'd almost be certainly expected to know Git or some other version control system, although Git is the most ubiquitous now. Once you have some usefulness some knowledge of how to use it, you'll see the usefulness of it, and you may choose to use it for version controlling other things besides, you know, really software. Like, for example, I use it all the time to track changes to papers I'm writing over time. So Git was originally written by Linus Torvald to manage the Linux kernel project. So Linus Torvald is also the guy who originally wrote the Linux kernel that we use and everybody's familiar with. There are other version control systems like CVS and SVN. These are older version control systems. I can't imagine starting a new project today and using one of these. However, there are some older projects that still use them, although I think, you know, most people are transitioning to Git. There is another one called Mercurial, which uses the command hg, and it's very, very similar to Git in many respects, and it has some interesting features. But I'd say for the most part, everyone uses Git as a first pass version control system. So to create a repository, this would be, you know, a repository, or a lot of times we'll use the word repo for short, for shorthand. This is occurs in a directory where you want to store files. So, you know, in a directory that contains the files you want to track, you start a new repository by just simply typing git init. And so let's go over to the Cloud9 IDE and do that. So we'll first create a folder. We'll call it my repo. And then let's go in there and we'll create a few files. So just a couple text files that you could imagine are some kind of files that we want to have under version control, and we'll just type git init. And right there, initializing an empty git repository. And so, you know, at first glance, it doesn't look like we did anything. If you do a long listing of the directory, so if you type ls minus la, where you can see that there's now a folder that has a dot in front of it, .git. So anytime you have a folder that has a dot in front of it, it's hidden, or in fact, any file that has a dot in front of it, it's hidden in a regular listing, right? So we don't see it when we type ls, but if we do a long listing, ls minus la, then we do see it there. And it's not empty, there's things inside of it. So if we look at what's inside of it, then there's some information. And this contains the information that changes as the repository changes, okay? So going back here, then a couple of other things. If we want to add files to the repository, so just because there are files there, we haven't sort of added them into the version control yet. Git doesn't assume that everything in the folder you want to track changes on. And this is usually not the case. Usually you'll have some sort of secondary files in your folder that you don't necessarily want to track the changes on. For example, if you had a program that produced a large amount of output, but it was reproducible in the sense that you could, say, run the code every time and it would produce this output, the same output, then you probably don't want to store that output because it takes up a lot of space that's unnecessary because you can reproduce it every time. So to get a listing of the tracked and untracked files, you can use git status. And then to actually add the files into the repository for tracking, then you can use the git add, and you can do this explicitly, or you can add everything in the directory if you add a dot. Remember, dot is a shortcut for this directory. So if you want to add everything in this directory, you would just say git add dot. So let's go ahead and take a look at this. By the way, you might notice that the prompt changed a little bit. Now there's this master here that wasn't there before. That indicates, and that's the default branch. We'll talk more about what branches are in a second, but master is the default branch for my repository, okay? and it shows up there on my command line. So anyway, if we type git status, we can see that there are no commits yet, meaning that, you know, we haven't actually added or tracked anything. A commit is like a snapshot in time that we're going to save. So we have no tracked files, but there are two untracked files, file one and file two. So let's just add one of them for now. So if we just say git add file one.txt, and then we type git status, you can see there's one new file now in green that's been added. So this is a ready to be committed, right? So if the next step is to commit this, and we'll see what that is on the next slide, right? So when we want to commit, then we'll type the command git commit dash m, and then you can put a message, a short message on the command line. If you wanted a longer message, then you could leave off the dot m and it would open up your editor. Whatever editor is stored in the environment variable editor within your development system machine would automatically open, and then you could type in a longer message, okay? The last thing there, and I'll give an example of this, is if you use a dash A, then you can skip the add command. So in other words, if you use the dash A, you're just continuing to track or making a commit with the files that have been tracked previously. You're not adding any new files per se. And so again, the best thing here to do is to work through some examples. So the first thing we'll do is go ahead and do a commit, and we'll add a message. So we'll just say my first commit. Okay, not a great commit message, but and so now we've made a commit, and we can look at the history of commits with the command git log, right? And so if you look at the log there, it says, you know, the commit message, my first commit, my name and when it happened, and then you also have this long hash string here that is a unique identifier to that commit, and we can use that later to sort of go back in time. So if we make changes to our code, and then ultimately we don't want those changes, we want to throw it away because possibly we made a mistake or we had some idea that didn't work out, then we can go back in history, and those are identified by those commit messages. So we have another file there we can add. So to make a second commit, so we'll go ahead and just do git add dot, which means we're going to add everything in the directory this time. And if we do git status, you'll see that there's one new file now, file two, because we didn't add it into the first commit. So we'll go ahead and make another commit, git commit. This time I'll use the am and add a second commit message. So again, not very original, but I'll just say my second commit, and then we can type git log, and we can see, you know, there's the two commits, okay? So now let's do something a little more interesting. I guess let's go ahead and make a change to one of the files. So we can say myfile.txt, and let's, you know, add some text. So I can do cat. So cat will print the output of a file. So if I type cat myfile1.txt, you can see the text inside the file is simply add some text that's there. Okay. One of the things I can do is I can, you know, say I added this text and it turned out to be a mistake. I don't want to do this. Well, I can go back in time by just simply writing git checkout dash dash file one txt. And what that did was it checked out file one from the latest version of the repository. So in the latest version of the repository, the last time I made a commit, there was no text inside file one. So if I type cat file1.txt, now there's nothing inside it again. So basically it got rid of the changes on that, at least on that one file. It got rid of the changes. Now, if you want to get rid of changes to the whole repository, then you have to do something a little more interesting. So here's some information about how to write good commit messages. So if you make a lot of changes, if your commits involve, you know, say hundreds of lines of changes, you probably want to detail what they're about. And so the way you would write a good commit message, there's some information here about how to do that. Essentially, you want to have one short descriptive message in the first line, followed by a couple of spaces and then more details, bullet points, whatever. You can exclude files, so there's a special file that's called .gitignore, which doesn't exist in our directory, but we can create it. And so if we do that, if we say touch .gitignore, which will create that file, we can then do a git status, and you see that it's telling us that gitignore is not tracked. Okay, usually you want to track your gitignore file, but if you didn't, if you didn't like the fact that it shows up there all the time. So this is again in the example here, is a case where you have files, possibly outputs from your program or whatever, that you don't want to show up every time you type git status because they're always there and you never want to track them. Well, you can add them to the gitignore file and they won't show up. So in this case, we'll open the gitignore file. And we'll actually just add gitignore to itself. And now when we type git status, you'll see that that's not there because we're ignoring it, right? So there's, and it's telling me there's nothing to commit. We haven't changed anything, right? So if we change one of the files, or for example, if we say added a third file to the repository, and then we write git status, there that file is. Now let's say this is a file we don't want to see, we don't want to attract. So again, we can add it to the gitignore file. In this case, file 3.txt. And again, if we type git status, there's nothing there. Right? So it's not, it's ignoring those files. It's not going to attempt to track them ever. Okay? So that's a special file, the gitignore file. If you want to remove files that are tracked in your repository, then you can use the git remove file. So this will actually erase it from the repository history and tracking, but it will also physically remove it from the hard disk if you use git remove. If you only want to remove the file from the git repository and tracking, but you don't want to actually physically remove it, then you can type git remove cached file, right? So in this case, we know we're tracking file 1 and file 2. Let's remove one of those. Not physically, but from the history, right? So if I say git remove cached file 2, which is a file that we've been tracking, right? You can see it's still there. I didn't physically remove it from the hard drive. But now if I type git status, it shows up that it's an untracked file. So again, we can begin tracking it again. If later we change our mind, then we can just say git add file 2.txt, git commit, add back file 2. It's a good commit message. Again, so now we have we didn't, since all we did was remove it and then we didn't commit, so let's go through that exercise one more time. So I'm going to remove the cache file and then I'm going to make a commit, right? So in this case, I'll just say removed file 2 from tracking. Okay, so now if we type git log, you'll see that commit. But then now we can change our mind. We can then add it back. So git add file 2 and then git commit added file 2. So there we see the four commits, my first commit, my second commit, remove file 2 and added file 2. Okay. So so if we want to now go back in time, not for a single file, but we actually want to revert the whole repository to a place in history, we can use these git revert commands. If you want to just go back one commit, you can use the word head. If you want to go back three commits, use the syntax head tilde 3. That would take you back three commits from the most recent one. I think the most useful thing to do and the sort of least dangerous, so you know exactly where you're going, is to use the hashtag. So again, we have the git log there. Let's say we want to go back to my second commit and get rid of all changes that occurred after that. Well, we would just say git revert, and then we put in enough of the string to make it unique, which usually is just six or seven letters. So db37612, that's enough. It gives you the option to have a commit message. In this case, it opened the nano. Not going to add anything to the commit message, but now then you see it took us back. So it reverted the commit back to, so the commit message it created was revert my second commit, right? So this takes the whole repository back to the point in time where you have that. And so here, git status. If you remember at the second commit, there was no file 2, right? So we went back in time, essentially. So if you want to actually go back in time and forget all of the history that happened that. So if you use the revert command, basically it preserves the commit history but takes the repository back to that place in time. If we actually want to throw away all of the history that's occurred since then we can use this git reset. And so, again, it's very similar, but it's a subtle difference. If you use revert, you're taking the repository back to the state in time, but you're preserving the commit history, meaning you could actually go back to those intermediate steps. If you want to actually get rid of them, reset the repository back, then we can use this reset command. Right? So in this case, we'll go back to the same commit, but we'll type reset dash hard. Right? And in this case, now if I type git log, you'll see everything is gone after my second commit. It's completely been erased from the version control history. So the main thing we're going to use the Git for in this class is cloning remote repositories. So when I say remote, I mean repositories that aren't local to your machine. They weren't created in your workspace. And primarily we're going to do this with respect to cloning assignments that are created for you in GitHub. And we'll talk about what GitHub is in a second, right? Here's an example of a git clone command that clones a set of files from my repository. For the example here, I'll go ahead and work one with respect to the examples in our class, right? So we're gonna go to GitHub. If you're logged in, it'll take you immediately to your login. In my case, I am part of several organizations, so I'm going to go to my profile. I'm going to go to the organization that's associated with this class. There are several of you have already begun to clone some of the repositories. And anyway, so here's the first assignment repository that's associated with my own. And so what we're going to do is if you go over here to where it says clone or download and you click that, then it says clone with HTTPS. If you click this little button right here, it'll actually copy this command to the clipboard. And so then you can go back to your IDE and you can just type out, well, let's go to a different repository. So in this case, let's go back to Workspace, and then I'm going to type git clone, and I'm going to paste that repository name into the command window, and then it's going to ask me what my username and password are. And then once it does that, it'll create the repository locally, right? So now I can go into assignment one, and there are the files, including the solution. So I'm going to go ahead and erase that so I don't make a mistake and actually publish the solution of the assignment one on this video. So so here we are. We have our repository. In this case, the idea is to create the solution, which is just a file, and put something in it, and then push it back to the repository. So we'll talk more about how to push, but basically this is the clone command. So basically we've taken this central or remote repository that was stored on GitHub, and now we have a local copy of it so that we can make changes to it here locally on your own machine. So again, if you do make changes and you push them to the central repository, again, here's the central repository. It has a solution file there. I'm not going to click on it because you'll get to see the solution. But nevertheless, if I go here and I'm going to create a solution, I'm actually going to create the wrong solution, but I'm going to open a file, solution.txt, and then I'm going to put some text in it. So this is my text for demonstration purposes. Now, this is not the right solution to this homework assignment, but nevertheless, what you'll see then, if I type git status, I've modified solution.txt. In this case, I've changed it from the correct answer to an incorrect one. And so if I add that file, then if I type git status, it'll be in green, meaning it's ready for commit. Then I can say git commit demo wrong answer commit. And then the last step is I'm going to push it back to the original repository. So I'm going to type git push. This is going to push it back to GitHub, but push it back to the cloud. So git push, and the next two commands are sometimes not necessary, but let's just go over what they are. Origin, this is the name of the remote repository. And so unless you give it another name, it's automatically going to be origin. So origin is corresponding to the GitHub, the remote repository on GitHub. And then the branch that we want to push. Well, we haven't created any other branches. So in this case, master would be the master branch. And again, if you don't need to put these if you don't have any other remote repositories or any other branches. You may be asked to put in your username and password. Okay, so now that's been pushed back to GitHub, and if we go back to GitHub, and I click on this solution.txt file, you'll see this is what I wrote. This is my text for demonstration purposes. So this has now been pushed to the cloud, and you'll see that. Now, the thing is, if you go here and you go to the commits, so these are the commit history of messages, you see this green check mark here? This was when I submitted the correct answer. This went on to some testing, and this build passed, so there's a green check mark there. Here you see a yellow dot, means that the build is in progress. It's going to check this answer, and eventually that's going to turn into a red X because it is the wrong answer that I committed. So there'll be a red X here. So this is a way to test from GitHub, which we'll talk more about in a second, but this is a way to test whether you have the correct answer or not, because the test will be run automatically for you. If you see the green check mark there, then you know you have the correct answer. If you see a red X, then you'll know you have an incorrect answer. So maybe the test shouldn't take very long, so maybe here in a minute we'll be able to look back here and see the red X I'm discussing. So there are some advanced features to Git, branching and merging. We won't talk, these are common things you would do in software development. Essentially, instead of working in your master directory, a lot of times what you would do is create a branch. So, I can create a branch. This allows kind of easy exploration. So what I can do is I can say git, in this case, I'm going to say git checkout, a new branch, and I'll give the new branch a name, like my experimental branch. Right? And so now you see where it used to say master here, now it says my experimental branch. So now I've checked out a new branch, and I can add new files. So I could create some new code. So if I create my new file there, some text like that, and we have this. Then I can go ahead and make a commit here, so git commit. In this case, I'm sorry, I need to add it. So add my new file, git commit, you know, first commit on experimental branch, right? Well, so then let's say I want to go back to the master branch where I haven't made any changes. Then I would say git checkout master. And you see, you notice my new file is gone, right? Because it's been committed in the experimental branch, but it's not in the master branch. So again, I can type git checkout my experimental branch, and my new file is there. I can type git checkout master, and my new file is not. Now let's say that I developed that other branch to a point where you know, I was ready to bring those changes into the master branch to make them sort of official, if you will. Well, then I could just type git merge, in this case, master my experimental branch. And now my new file is there and it's part of master. And if you do a git log, you'll see that the history, my first commit on experimental branch, has actually been added to the history of master. So this is a short demonstration of how you do branching and merging. And I'm not sure how much of that we'll do in this class, but that's an idea, okay? So the next thing is GitHub. So we've already seen GitHub a little bit. It's located at the website, github.com. You should have signed up for an account by now. But it's essentially a cloud-based remote repository server. So all the files are served in the cloud there, and they're stored there. There's unlimited public repositories. So public means anyone can see them. Anyone who signs up for an account gets unlimited public repositories. And there are private repositories available, meaning that you know only you or the people you allowed can see the code. In this case, all of your assignments are private repositories so that you can't see each other's code. But I have an educational plan that any student can actually sign up for, and then you get unlimited private repositories as well. You can also have teams and organizations would help, you know, usually on large software development projects, there's multiple people working on it. And there's also these so-called pull requests. So these are features where people from the outside can actually submit merge requests, if you will, to your code to fix bugs or add new features. And then there's an integrated code review system that allows you to look over that. So there's other services similar to GitHub. They provide the same essential features. The key difference is usually in the business model of how the private repositories are priced. And a couple of common ones are Bitbucket and GitLab. Again, so we've already seen, you know, if we go back to GitHub.com, we've already seen essentially, you know, so this is my homepage where I'm taken immediately when I log in. So again, if we go to profile, go back to my organization over here that I'm a part of, then go to this assignment that I just sort of submitted the incorrect answer to, we should be able at this point to go in and look at the commits, and we see the red X I was talking about. So this red X means that, you know, now the build is not passing, right? Whereas it was before. Well, one thing I could do, a simple way to fix this, is just to revert the repository back to this submit assignment. So this is the last thing I'll do, go back to the Cloud9 IDE, into the assignment, look at the git log, and what I want to do is I'm going to do a git reset hard, and I want to take it back to the commit where I have the correct answer, so submit assignment. This is 56A6, right? So 56A6F7, right? Now if I say git log, you see everything, all those wrong changes I made after that are gone. The solution is there. I'm not going to open it because you'll see what the solution is. But anyway, then if I just type git push, this will, after a login, send it back to GitHub with the correct answer. Oh, it turns out because I reverted, what's in the cloud is actually ahead of what is here locally. it doesn't in general allow you to do that unless you add an F, right? So because it doesn't want you to erase work that maybe somebody else had placed ahead of you in the cloud. You know, if you're working on a team, you don't want to push the things that are going to change, you know, work that someone else done. So you have to be a little more careful. This would not be a normal use case scenario. You're not in our class. We're not normally going to reset repositories. But if you're sure that you really want to push it, in this case, erasing those changes that I made, then I just add the dash F on the front, and again, log in. So now if we go back here, those commits have been erased, and so we're back at submit assignment. It is going to go ahead and run the test again, and of course, since we know this already passed, it's going to pass in the future. So if we check back in a few minutes, you would see a green check mark there.